So good. It's not like you fold your arms. But it's like you just take your arms and just wrap yourself like that. Knowing that he loves you like that. Knowing that he loves you like that. Sometimes when we're going through some things that in our life and the enemy would seem that he is getting the better of us, Bill, it seems like we get weary and worn out.
Not weary.
Yeah. If you have your Bibles, I want to take you on a journey real quick. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. If you would, go with me over to 2 Corinthians. The book of 2 Corinthians. Thank you, Lord. The book of 2 Corinthians. Find the fourth chapter.
Amen.
Begin at verse number 7 of the fourth chapter of 2 Corinthians, you find these words. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that life also, Jesus, might be made manifest in our body. If I had a thought, Monique, I would probably go down this path if you don't mind. I'm fired up, but I'm not burned out. Well, come on, somebody. I'm fired up, but I'm not burned out. Oh, go with me, somebody. Hallelujah. Father, I pray that you bless the hearer. So, God, that we become doers of your word and not hearers only. Father, may someone be blessed by this message today. And Lord, as we overcome some of these toughest problems of life, Lord, take us on the journey to overcoming. And God, we give you praise that you can fire us up, that we not get burned out. And Lord, we give you praise in Jesus' name. The people of God say amen.
Amen.
Oh, you can take your seat in the house of the Lord. How much light does a burning out light bulb produce? None. You're right. None. How much light does a burning out Christian produce? None. See, burnout occurs when we give more than we take in. Come on, somebody. Burnout doesn't happen overnight. Come on, talk to me. See, burning out happens over a period of time. Are you praying with me? Such a lifestyle, it works fine for a little while. Now, many of y'all probably know that I'm an A-type personality. Amen. Praise the Lord. I can't seem to have enough on my plate. Come on, somebody. Some of you all may be A-type personalities as well. Praise the Lord. In other words, enough is never enough. There's always something else. You can't seem to say no. Come on, talk to me. And so, but finally you get to the point, mother, of almost exhaustion. Are you praying with me? Now, we get what I call spiritually zapped. Look at somebody who says spiritually zapped.
Spiritually zapped.
Our motivation leaves us. Hello. And we can't seem to stand the very thought of another obligation or responsibility. Some of us have just too many things going on. Are you praying with me? And so I want us to begin to recognize when we're there at this point of burning out. Amen. You need to stay fired up. Come on, stop committing. But just don't burn out. Amen. Now, someone, Pastor Ray probably said, but Pastor, what is burning out? Well, burnout, first of all, is a mental thing, it's a physical thing, and it's also a spiritual thing. Pray with me, somebody. In other words, it will result in that there's too much stress going on over a long period. period of time. And so A-type personalities seem to never have enough time. So there's not a type. We tend to move, we tend to walk, we tend to talk, amen. And we're doing it because we don't have enough time to stay on one thing. Are you praying with me? Amen. So in other words, Brother Meyer, we're always in a hurry. Yeah. Amen. We, matter of fact, when someone is talking to us, we get to go ahead and get up, you know, finish up what you got to say to them because I got another thing to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
And A-types, amen, when we're sitting in, amen, we tend to just shovel it in. We don't even taste the food, but we'll just eat it, amen. And so burnout, amen, happens like this. We get upset when we're waiting for the train or we're waiting in traffic, amen. Anybody like that?
Yeah.
Now, Archel, I know that, amen, I don't know whether you're A-type or B-type, but I know you're some type. We just get what we call impatient. Are you praying for me? Some of us have been in cars with people like that. We talk to the other cars even though they don't hear us. We talk to other folk that drive by us, but they don't hear us. Amen. Because we're at the point where we don't have enough time. Psalms 37:7 says this, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. It's the patiently waiting part that we have a problem with. Come on, pray with me somebody. So even if you're not an A-type, amen, you can live like an A-type, amen. See, you still experience burnout. Anyone, look at somebody and say anyone.
Anyone
can experience burnout. Are you praying with me? Burnout causes us to see our jobs as just boring jobs. I don't know why I need to go into work today. Come on, talk to me somebody. Not the places of ministry like we ought to be looking at it. See, we ought to be fired up going to our workplace.
Amen.
Oh, somebody quiet. Let me say it again. Some of us ought to be fired up going to our job. But if you're looking at your workplace as a boring place because it's just too mundane for us, then you've overlooked why God has you at the job to begin with. See, God placed you at your job so you can minister to somebody.
Amen.
And you ought to be thankful, amen, that you got a
job. Amen.
Okay, if you're not happy that you got a job, then quit and give it to somebody else. But just know that there's a result of you just walking away from your job. Amen. You got bills in the world. I'll leave the rest of the... You got bills to pay.
Yeah.
But I'm just trying to get you to get fired up about the job you got to start looking at it as a ministry opportunity. To be able to minister to somebody. Are you praying with me?
Yeah.
And so, remember, these are places of ministry and a mission, amen. And so when we're burned out, we are just putting in time. We're just putting in time. We go through the motions. Then we go home and then we go through the... Some of us, Lord, should I say this? Yes. Some of us just go home and we'll stay at work long so we don't have to deal with home. We'll stay at work so by the time we get home, we don't have to minister to anyone.
All right now.
Because we just want to get it to cover up and then to start the most dreadful day all over again tomorrow. Oh, I don't want to go to work. Can I just, let me just leave her home. So, we get tired of everyone, come on, talk to me, and everything. See, burnout causes us to lose interest in our relationships. Talk back to me, somebody. See, it's quiet, and y'all love it. See, let it get quiet, because you need to listen to this. See, because burnout will cause you to lose interest in your relationships. In Jeremiah 31:25, the Bible says, for I will satisfy the weary soul, and every languishing soul will I replenish. God says, I will satisfy all the languishing of a weary soul, and every languishing soul he will replenish. Pray with me, somebody.
Yes.
Get fired up over here. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm fired up.
Fired up.
See, in a Christian's life, we tend to struggle with burnout all the time. Pray with me, somebody. Becoming weary and needing our souls replenished, we need to get fired up again.
Yes.
See, burnout is the state of our mental, physical, and spiritual exhaustion. So, but Pastor, how do I recognize when I'm at that point? Brother, what I need to be recognizing when I'm getting close to being burned out.
All
right. I'm going to give you three things. You need to write these down. These are important. Don't miss them, amen. There are three things that help us recognize our common feelings of burnout. First of all, when you feel unappreciated. When you feel unappreciated. Come on, Holy Spirit. Sometimes we get burned out like Moses was leading the stiff-necked, messed up, stubborn Israelites in the wilderness for several years. See, burnout shows up in our prayers. What did Moses pray in Numbers 11:11? Here's what Moses began to pray. He said, why have you treated me like this, your servant? And why have I not found favor in your sight that you would lay the burden of all these people upon me? Burnout shows up in our prayer life. Oh, y'all quiet. Y'all quiet. See, we start praying prayers just like that. We begin to blame God for the things. Amen. Because we don't stay fired up, we start getting burned out. See, we are burned out. We feel like someone is always wanting something from us, and no one has ever wanted anything to help us. Oh, talk back to me, somebody. Wait a minute if this is getting through to anybody. So we feel the burden of all these
people.
Now, if you're not feeling that way, it means you're not doing too much. We feel, when we feel unappreciated, we have feelings of resentment. We have feelings of bitterness. We have feelings of even anger towards others.
Hallelujah.
Pray with me, somebody.
Amen.
This is because we feel like no one appreciates what I've done.
Yes.
And no one's appreciating what I'm doing. No one is patting me on the back, Judy. No one is saying, good job. I don't feel appreciated. But let me say this. I thank God. Pastor, you weren't here last week, but they appreciated us. Amen. I brought all the gifts home because they appreciate us. They appreciate us. And that's why I was able to post on Facebook how the people of God that we serve appreciates us. See, because what we do is not overlooked. So all I'm saying to you, Janelle, that your pastors are not burned out.
Amen.
We're fired up. Amen. Bring it on. Let me find out what the next chapter is going to be like. We're talking about 10 years next year. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
See, they counted us out in year one, but they didn't think that we would make it.
Yeah.
Right now.
Oh, if they only knew what he knew.
Yeah.
And if they only thought like he thought.
Yeah.
That I knew what these people were going to do. Stay fired up. Don't get burned out. Secondly, you can recognize burnout when you feel overwhelmed. Pray with me, somebody. Burnout causes us to feel that we don't have the time and energy for all of these must-do everyday things. I gotta do this. I gotta do that. So we begin to question our decisions and we question our abilities. We feel overwhelmed. Anybody feel overwhelmed?
Right.
Feel like you don't have a whole lot of time to do everything. We feel overwhelmed. We may feel what the psalmist felt in Psalms 22:15, where he says, my strength is dried up like a potsherd. Now, a potsherd, if you've ever known what a potsherd is, brother, it's those pieces of fragment, ceramic, little things that you go out as an archaeologist and find lying in the desert somewhere that's been exposed to the sun. Little pieces. You don't know what it was to, and it's not even recognizable of what it was. Because burnout makes you feel overwhelmed. You need to recognize when you're in over your head.
Yes.
You need to recognize when things are coming in on you like that. How many of you felt overwhelmed this week? I see some hands. See, the potsherd is a useless little piece of pottery. Burnout causes us to feel the lack of stamina and the ability, our inability to cope with life itself, and we feel useless. Who could use me in this shape that I'm in? How, God, could you possibly use this mess of a person that I feel like, right? And the last way, a third way, is that when we feel unhappy. Now, nobody have to tell me this, amen, but I know that there have been some unhappy moments this week. So you're not always happy 24/7. Come on, talk to me. I just got to be real, Simone. We're not always happy 24/7. But the question is, when I'm not happy, what do I do with myself? In Ecclesiastes 2:11, Solomon writes, he says, then I considered all that my hands had done and the toil I had experienced in doing it, and behold, all was vanity. See, burnout contaminates our vision. Talk to me, somebody. Burnout contaminates our vision, causing you to see everything in a negative. Are y'all praying with me today? Whatever you whatever you go and whatever you do, you won't be happy. Nothing seems to satisfy you, because guess who goes with you everywhere you go? You do. Your distorted, your burned out attitude, perspective, it ruins everything, because you go with you everywhere. There was a little boy. He sneaked into the bedroom of his grandfather. I have to tell them stories like this. I should. The little boy goes in to his grandfather's room, and his grandfather was sleeping on the couch, and he takes some Limburger cheese. And he smears it in his grandfather's mustache. So his grandfather wakes up, Robin, and the first thing he said, it stinks in this room. And he goes then to the next room, and that room, he said, it stinks in here too. Then he walks out of that room and he goes outside so he gets some fresh air, and he takes a deep breath. He said, this whole world stinks. But that's how we are sometimes. Because we go out like that everywhere we are, and we bring the negative, we stink. And no matter where we go, you go with you. And wherever you go, you stink the place up. Because rather than washing your clean up your attitude everywhere you go. Burnout gives us a Limburger cheese attitude. Wherever we go, we think the world stinks. But the world isn't the place that stinks, it's our attitude that stinks. Talk to me, something. So when we think the world stinks, we're probably suffering from burnout. See, burnout makes us feel unappreciated, overwhelmed, and what? Unhappy. Therefore, we need to know how to get ourselves fixed. So how do I beat burnout? Minister Marine, we have to live well, laugh much, and love often.
Amen.
Hello. We have to remember to one of the first things that I'm going to recommend to you, say me.
Yeah.
I need to laugh sometimes. We sit over here, we can't even laugh.
Yes.
But you need to laugh sometimes.
Yes.
It'll help you with, see, here's what people don't understand, Judith. Don't take life so seriously, but instead, we need to develop a sense of humor. See, God has this sense of humor. If you don't believe me, go look in the mirror. He did not make you like anybody else. He made you like him. Now, how he looks, you look.
Yeah.
You may laugh at yourself, and if you can't laugh at you, sometimes I don't know about you. Can I just tell a little bit of this? I promise it won't be. It'll be fine. There are moments she don't know this, but there are moments I will stand in front of the mirror. See, I'm trying to see what she sees in me. She'd have been with me almost 30 years, and I'm just trying to see, what is this woman seeing in me? And so I know the hold is so low. But what I've noticed is that I'm not what I used to be. Somebody missed that.
Come on.
I'm better than I used to be. Because then I was in the Word. But now that I'm in the Word, I look better. So I now know what she sees in me. She sees the God in me. Isn't that good? So, in Proverbs 17:22, this is what I want to give you. It says, a merry heart does good like a medicine. A merry heart makes good like a medicine. Proverbs 17:22, a merry heart does good like a medicine. Go ahead and say laughter does the body good. See, we say milk does the body good. But laughter does the body good. See, what we don't realize is that laughter sets off some endorphins inside of us. And the things that used to bother us, amen, it promotes a feeling of happiness inside of us. Amen. We start feeling really good. Look, there were about 10 men here yesterday, amen. And we sat down and we realized we need to get back to ministry. And we had some laughing moments. Praise the Lord. And it felt, say it with me again, that was good.
Good.
It felt good. And so if we don't laugh, amen, we'll exaggerate our problems like Pinocchio.
Yes.
See, the problem is really that I got a little ingrown toenail. My whole leg hurts. Oh my God, my leg hurts. But wait a minute. The truth of the matter is, it's just an ingrown toenail. But it causes me to exaggerate everything. My problem is, it's so big. You, Pastor, I got this huge problem. Son, what is it? What was your problem? Well, my toenail has ingrown, but it got me. It, see, eventually we'll say my whole body.
Yeah, right now.
You know, Pinocchio was a little wooden figure that was a little boy made by Papa Geppetto, who was a toy maker, and the little boy somehow or another, through some miraculous means, came to life. You know, it's a fantasy thing. But every time the child lied. I wonder how big our noses would be. I just wonder how big our nose would be if we keep exaggerating our problem. I just wonder how long. Louis quiet. Little Johnny went to Sunday school and he learned that God created everything to include human beings, and he was surprised to find out that God created Eve from the rib of Adam. And later on in the week, Johnny was having a discussion, and he was sitting on the couch, and his mother noticed that he looked ill and was somewhere in pain as he lay on the sofa. So she asked Johnny, she says, "What's the matter, baby? You don't look good. You look like you're in pain." And he said, "Mom," he said, "I have a pain in my side. I think I'm going to have a wife." We got to remember to laugh. We just do. We got to remember to laugh. Amen. But here's something else that I can give you, though. You not only have to remember to laugh, but you also have to remember to vent to somebody.
Yes.
You got to remember to vent to somebody. See, I'm laughing about that. I mean, you got to learn to vent to somebody. The reason we got to, but before I say to somebody, I need to qualify it. I need to qualify it. See, sometimes we're still venting to these same old friends who have been lying to you all these years. See, because you keep going to them, they're going to keep telling you what's against God. So I need to go. See, some of us still got these friends that we need to let go of from years gone by. Amen. They were good for you. No, they were never good for you. They were never good for you because I'm going to tell you, they always were around to get you in more trouble. So we got to learn to go to some Christian friends. Amen. You need to go, you need to change up the friends that you had. Amen. You go to them and you need to vent to them. Now here's what you're going to find out when you vent to them. Chiquita, you're going to find out when you vent to somebody that's saved, they're going to tell you what thus say the Lord. And they won't tell you what they haven't been through themselves. They'll tell you, "Let me tell you what I went through. And here, let me tell you what God did for me in my going through. He was there with me all of the way."
Yes.
Yeah, we got to change up some things. You need to go to somebody who's like that. And see, Proverbs 17:17 says, "He's a friend who loves it." Say it with me. All times. Spiritual friends. Someone who is able to make sure that they are giving us what we call sound advice. Now, listen. A true friend knows everything about us. Our warts. Our hang-ups. Our little issues. Our little problems. They know some things that you haven't even told the world. But I'm learning that people don't seem to have a problem getting on Facebook. Amen. And they wonder how everybody else knows. Who told the world about your issues? Mm-hmm. Say it with me.
You did.
No, you did. I didn't do it. You did. I didn't do it. Oh, don't be blaming me for your stuff that you post on Facebook. So, if we're going to beat burnout, we got to remember to what? Laugh. And then what? Talk to a Christian friend about it. So they can give us some sound advice. And then lastly, make sure that we take a look at our commitments. Amen. Let's take a look at our commitments. See, burnout occurs when we have too many irons. Fired up! That burnout. So I'm learning to take some irons. Come on. I need to learn to take some irons.
Yes.
Reveal your commitments. See, because too many irons in the fire will cause the fire to. When we have too many irons in the fire, we lose our spiritual fire. Because we what? Get over So how can I avoid getting burned out? Go with me to Hebrews 12. Praise the Lord. I'm glad that you asked that question. I don't know who you were, but I'm glad that you asked that question. Hebrews, did I say 12? Amen. Hebrews chapter 12. Let me know when you get there.
Amen.
Look at this, Hebrews 12. Look at verse number what? 1. Wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of what? Let us lay aside every what? Weight. And what sin which does so easily beset us. And then we can do what?
Run.
We got to lighten our what? Load. We got to take some things what? Off. We got to take some irons what? Out. So we don't get what? Burned out. A few years ago, I knew of a guy who had a sailboat, and he kept the sailboat tied in a lake. I think the lake was Lake Texoma. But every 2 years, you would notice that he'd have to go and have the algae and the barnacles scraped off the hull of the boat. Amen. And the reason he had to clean the bottom of the boat and then get it repainted is because if he didn't shave off the barnacles and the algae that was collecting, and because it was sitting too long, it would cause a drag on the boat. It would not go through the what waves of the water, what smooth. There'd be some what drag on the boat. So, if we don't take some of this stuff the same way life is, if we don't take some of this algae off of us, if we don't take some of these barnacles off of us, about every couple of years, you're going to accumulate some stuff. I'm not saying anybody, I'm just saying, about every couple of years, you might need to scrape some stuff. Re-examine your boat. Otherwise, you're getting what? Some drag on your life. And you'll get, next thing you know, you'll what? Slow down. So to be burnt out, you got to what? Remember to what? Laugh. Vent to someone who can listen to us that's Christian, and then make sure that we what? Take a look at our commitments.
Yes.
And then lastly, we need to what? Refocus on God.
Yeah.
That's why we're closing.
Yeah.
Again, live well, laugh often, and love much. We need to refocus on God. Two words describe when we find ourselves in burnout. We're weary and we're weak. We're weary and we're weak. So when suffering burnout, I want you to remember my favorite scripture out of the Bible. Isaiah 41:1 says, they that
wait
upon the Lord. It ain't about waiting, amen. It's about waiting upon the what? The Lord. We need to wait upon the Lord. See, we receive this gift of truth from God. It tells us that if we just wait on Him, our power will return, our energy will come up. But however, we must ask ourselves for that power and that energy. See, burnout is caused by us by focusing on too many things rather than on God. Focusing on God keeps our life on course and set our priorities in order, and it prevents us from getting overloaded and overwhelmed.
Yes.
If we keep our focus on the Lord. Are y'all praying with me?
Amen.
So when we refocus on God, His purpose for our lives, it begins to make sense, and peace will come to our life when we focus on the Lord. Look at somebody and say, focusing on the Lord. When we focus on the Lord, He tells us that our life will be renewed. Amen. He said we'll mount up with what? Wings as eagles. We're going to fly over the situation. So in order for me to be burnt out, I got to realize I need to what? Wait on the Lord. Now, I believe, Pastor Ray, in your studies, the word wait, I hope I pronounced this right, kava, amen. It means that I'm waiting patiently while yet expecting. I'm waiting patiently, but yet expecting. See, a lot of us look at waiting as a time frame, but it's a spiritual position. Waiting is a spiritual position when we're waiting on the Lord, because you're patiently what? Waiting, yet expecting.
Yes.
And I want to make sure that we're yet what? Expecting. Everything God does in our lives, He does by faith, including helping us be burnt out. See, in Matthew 9:29, we need to be like that. Amen. We need to be just like that. Patiently waiting, but yet with expectation.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need to be like a remote plane or a drone. Notice what happens. When a drone gets out of range, it tends to just wander aimlessly with no sense of direction. But they start putting a chip inside of them that says, let me hover until I reconnect. And then once it reconnects, it can be directed. God put a chip in me. But not let me have a chip on me. Lord, put a chip in me so that when I seem to be very burnt out, I need to get into a hover until I reconnect. And then once I reconnect, then you can die. Come on, somebody. See, that's what we need to learn to do. Rather than just keep aimlessly going away from God, we need to hover where we last felt God. Oh, come on, somebody. We need to stay right there, hovering, until we have that spiritual connection again. And once we get it, God can then direct. Take me to the next mission, Lord. It's because I know that what God is going to do, He's going to keep on directing me. Here's what Proverbs 3 says. Proverbs 3 says, trust in the Lord and lean not to my own understanding. But in all my ways, acknowledge Him. That's my ship. That's my chip right there. I gotta see when I said acknowledge Him, that's my chip. And then He says, and He will direct. So I got to stay hovering to reconnect so He can direct. So I got to stay what? Hovering. So I can what? Reconnect so He can what? Direct. Anybody experiencing spiritual burnout? Come on, talk to me. Don't lie to me. This is for you, because it was for me.
Yeah.
It was for me.
Yeah.
I had to learn this.
Yeah.
And the Lord said, if you think it's for them, you're right, but it's for you too. Because
right.
I don't want you simply to experience burnout. Right. I want you to stay fired up.
Yes. Right.
Because a little spark, all it takes is just a little spark.
Yeah.
And it'll fire other sparks.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
I don't know who you are, but amen. If you a little spark, amen, why don't you just come on here with me right now? If you're just a little spark. I need some little sparks. I need some little sparks around me, because we've got to start a fire today.
Yeah.